about 15 to 20 minutes long. The front end is focused on the overall official community plan and different ideas and goals that cut through the whole thing. But then we focus on Northern Park, and we did this when we came here about this time last year with the draft plan. What we're doing now is coming out with what we heard from North Park and what we've done with that feedback. In the front end of the presentation, Mark is going to run through the overall OCP, and then I'll be focusing on the North Park component, and then we'll open it up to questions. And we've got about 30 minutes, so we have plenty of time to get into however much detail everybody would like to get into.
Great. Thank you very much, Helen. We're very happy to be here tonight, especially because last month we were supposed to be here and weren't able to make it. I'm not sure if you all know, but we had a bit of a mix-up with the location.
We spent half an hour roaming around SOFA trying to figure out what had gone wrong. So
we're especially happy to make it this time. You're actually the last group that we'll have this spring in this round of meetings. So it's good to be here. So we've all already been introduced. This is Helen Kane. I'm Mark Sion. We're both part of the OCP team at the City of Victoria in the Community Planning Division. And this team's been together since January 2010. I haven't been on the team the entire time. I just joined the team last year. But as a group, it's been together for almost 3 years now, since the start of the OCP process. So as Helen mentioned before, we're here to present some information as sort of another round in a feedback loop with the community association. Tonight we're here to present information in advance of the public hearing, thank you, which is coming up on the 27th of the month. And this is the final opportunity at that public hearing to have your submissions heard regarding the OCP to council officially. So there is a, just let me get to that in the next slide. Let me just back up. Tonight, I'll be going through OCP overview in the first 15 minutes or so. I'm giving you a broad look at some of the themes of the plan, just to touch on some of the highlights. Following that, Helen's going to take on some of the more direct North Park parts of the plan. We'll look at some more detailed neighborhood maps and talk about some of the directions for North Park at that time. And then at the end, we'll leave some information sheets regarding how to provide comments about what you've seen to council officially in a couple of weeks.
And you might have seen it around town already. We've got, this is a two-pager, which is very similar to handouts that we've had all the way through the process in terms of the look and feel of the handout. This does provide the three different ways that you can provide feedback, including actually going to the public hearing, and then simply either writing a letter or an email. At this point, what is different about our process is the feedback is going directly to Mayor and Council rather than planning staff. And that's because now this isn't a draft anymore, it's a proposed plan. And we've already had, there are three readings for an OCP. We've already had two. The third one is at the public hearing. And when this happens with a community plan process, all the staff actually are here to provide information, but the comments go directly to council. So all of that information, as well as our contact information, because yes, we're here today, but we're absolutely available to answer any questions after today. And also, the hearing is on the 27th. You have right up to the day before. But it is first thing in the morning the day before, but you still have a couple of weeks. So there's plenty of these, and maybe I'll circulate these as we go through.
Is your contact information on that?
It is. Email and phone.
Great. Thanks, Helen. I think the deadline is 11 a.m. the day before the public hearing.
It is.
So very quickly, an overview of what an OCP is. The purpose of an official community plan is to direct growth and change in the city of Victoria over the next 30 years. And it's designed to guide everybody, to give a common vision for everybody to follow. It guides council, staff, citizens, and also business owners. And it proactively responds to issues and opportunities and tries to create a vision for the next generation of Victoria. There's been a number of phases to the plan up to this point, and we're now getting toward the very final stage of the plan, which is the adoption process. To this point, there's been a very large community engagement process, which is actually the largest in the city's history. There's been over 6,000 people engaged in this process. And as I mentioned, it's been going on since early 2010. And one of the key goals of these engagement sessions was to engage a broad and diverse range of people. And to this end, there were actually quite a number of really innovative techniques that we used, including some of these electronic survey booths that you see, and some other sessions, for example, working with Victoria High School students. So there were a number of ways where we engaged the public over the past couple of years, and this evening tonight is actually part of that as we come back for another round of feedback and discussion. So recently, we released a draft OCP last year, that was sort of a midpoint in this OCP process where the public was able to come and look at the OCP in its initial draft and then provide feedback. And we've been hard at work for about a year now making modifications to that OCP. And I'll get into some of the changes and the details a little bit more as we go along. But what happened during this phase was that we had a bunch of community feedback come in regarding the draft OCP. Goals, values, ideas, and needs. So we took what we heard over the past year. The plan's evolved quite a bit into what's now the proposed OCP. So I'm going to quickly highlight a few key themes of the OCP and just going over some high-level content and trying to summarize what some of the major directions are of the plan. At its core, the OCP is a land use plan, land use and development. So that's really the bulk of the plan. Chapters, I believe, 6 and 7 cover land use and transportation. And those are really key themes for us. So one of the key regulatory tools for implementing this land use plan is urban place designations, which is what you see in front of you on the screen. And so for each color, it's coded to have different guidelines related to built form, place character features, uses, and density. So an example of a built form character, but a built form consideration would be whether a building is detached or detached, or for example, what the height is. So that will fall under built form. Place character features refers to things like whether or not the building is ground oriented or not, or for example, the types of parks and open spaces that you have in different neighborhoods. So you might have a plaza versus more of a urban park like Beacon Hill Park, depending on which neighborhood you're in. Uses refers to, for example, commercial, industrial, and residential uses. And density, well, these UPDs, as we call them, the urban place designations, they offer a wide range of densities. So there's actually, it doesn't really define them, but it does offer a range. This is the first major theme that I want to touch on about the OCP, and it refers to areas of growth and change. We have a growth concept in the OCP where basically over the next 30 years we're anticipating about 20,000 new residents across the city of Victoria. And we want to direct that population growth into really intelligent locations so that we can achieve all these other great outcomes, for example, that I'll touch on later, like walkable villages. So our growth concept involves this 50-40-10 concept where we have 50% of the future growth, half the future growth in the downtown core area, which is what you see in red in front of you and illustrated in the chart. The next 40%, not chronologically, but another 40% of residents would be in town centers and large urban villages, which you see as the purple dots in front of you. And the remaining 10% would be across the city in the yellow area, which are areas that we refer to as areas of minimal change. So So this growth concept really is supportive of many of the other related themes that I'll touch on in the next few slides, including a strong downtown and transit-oriented development, having these nodes across the city that are connected to one another. So one of the key things we heard from the public was a strong desire for walkable villages and town centers, whether it's enhancing the existing places that are very special to people, like the North Park Village, for example, and also creating new spaces that are really great. And the idea of completeness is really central to this. So we want to have mixed uses, and we'd like to see, well, not we, but the community told us that they would like to see a mixing of uses, walkable neighborhoods, places where you can go and go to the grocery store, go to the doctor, and have those things in your own village center.
Can you pop up the projector? It looks like we're starting to zoom in.
Was it dipping a little bit?
I don't see me underneath that.
It is a large document, so it's especially good for us. But it actually is designed to be very accessible. It's organized into chapters by themes, so you, as you read through it, you'll see a chapter on land use, you'll see a chapter on environment, and a whole other set of chapters, each dealing with a different theme, but also related to one another. So it's actually very accessible, even though it is a large document. Another key theme is downtown is the heart of the region. And this has a few different meanings. It's the cultural heart, but also the economic heart. We want it to stay that way and also enhance it in that role. Because it is the central business district of the entire region, not just the city of Victoria. So a few examples of ways to enhance downtown that are envisioned in the plan would be to enhance the role of the government sector in that area, to enhance the arts and entertainment in the downtown core, to increase the overall population base to support those services. Another key theme is a diversity of housing within neighborhoods and across the city. So that would refer to having several different types of housing in each neighborhood, a fair share in each neighborhood of the city, but also having new forms of housing in areas where it hasn't necessarily been before. We heard really strongly from the public that there was a desire for different forms of housing, different tenant structures, for example, and different looks and feels in different places. Sustainable transportation is very much central to the plan. It really supports the land use vision that I mentioned earlier and that growth concept, looking at the downtown and also those village centers. So transit-oriented development is a really important aspect of the plan. And along with that, there is a focus on complete streets, where you want every street to be useful for every transportation mode. And you don't want to have any streets that are off limits for a particular mode because it's dangerous, for example. Many options available in terms of transportation. Another key element of this is the transportation hierarchy, where we've put the pedestrian at the top, followed by the cyclist, the public transit, and then a single occupancy vehicle, which is something that's been done elsewhere, and it might be a common theme, might have heard it before, but that's something that's supportive in this plan as well. A more resilient city. Now there are three really great examples of how this is reflected in the plan, and they're actually very innovative as well. The first picture is of a fire station, and this reflects the chapter on emergency management in the plan, which is actually the first time that's been dealt with in an official community plan in BC to have that topic dealt with explicitly. So we're quite proud of that. There's also a chapter on climate change and energy. And lastly, there's also a chapter on food systems. We were not the first to address those issues, but they're quite cutting edge as well. Victoria's proposed OCP is also the first to introduce an adaptive management concept, which is part of the implementation plan for the OCP. And what it means is going back every few years and on a scheduled way, annual reporting, and looking at the plan and asking what's working and what isn't working, and having the ability to actually make adjustments as we go along. The last thing we want is to have this plan sit on the shelf for 20 years and get old and stale without being able to sort of reinvigorate it and check on our progress as we go along. So that's actually built into the plan itself, the ability to go back and monitor and make changes. Character areas and a sense of place. Victoria is full of really fantastic areas like in the picture. And the plan really supports enhancing these existing areas, absolutely protecting them, of course, and also providing new character areas. For example, these sort of squares and other places that are really cherished by local residents. So one of the key tools to actually achieve some of these outcomes in terms of regulation are development permit areas, which are new in this current draft. They weren't in last year's version because we hadn't developed them at the time. But they're not new to the City of Victoria. The existing OCP, which was from 1995, also has a development permit areas in it. You may be familiar with them. They've been changed a little bit in this round of the plan in some key ways. They've been simplified from 32 areas before down to 24, and that involves some conglomeration and some addition. So simplified overall. They've also been aligned with the urban place designations that I showed you before for consistency's sake. So if you had a designation like Hillside Mall in the town center designation, you have a matching development permit area on top of that. And what these areas, how these differ from the urban place designations, these are not land use areas. It's about design, and it's about making sure that development in these areas fits in with the character of the neighborhood. So we've proposed these development permit areas, building on what we had in the previous plan. So all lands that were controlled and regulated with DPAs, development permit areas, in the previous plan are carried forward into this one with a few other additions. That's the general trend of DPAs, although they've been simplified. Probably the most significant addition to the DPA library in the plan was the addition of DPA 16, which is an area designed to look at form and character. And it applies to a sort, this will be a little hard to explain, but it applies to all the areas that aren't in a current, that aren't in a proposed DPA. So what this does is it effectively covers the rest of the city. So if you see in front of you the areas outlined in purple, it's theoretically the area that it covers. It actually does not apply to all the properties in that area because it's designed to only deal with sort of larger scale development, and that's defined as residential structures that are more than three or more units, any commercial and any industrial. So that type of development, if it's to take place in the DPA 16 area, would fall under specific design guidelines that we've brought with us and we worked out specifically for this development permit area. And the goal of this area, and the reason why it applies to this area, which is basically the inverse of the other DPAs, is because this is the area that we don't expect a lot of development necessarily. It's more an area of stability because our other DPAs are actually targeted toward the areas of growth, for example, the downtown, the corridors, and the town centers. This DPA deals with everything else because the last thing you'd want is to have a development in one of those areas that doesn't fit with the community, because these are typically areas of relative stability. And so what this DPA does is ensure that any large-scale development in that area would have oversight by the city and by the communities. If you want to talk a little more about the DPA, we can do that a little bit later on with Helen as well. So strategically focused local area plans are another key theme, and the final theme of the OCP that I'll highlight for you. It's a new approach that wasn't there in the previous OCP, and the idea is planning where planning is needed. And so you see in front of you a few different shapes, and the point that this graphic is trying to make is that there are different areas and there are different sizes. We don't necessarily have to do a neighborhood plan for every single square inch of the city. What we should definitely do is do the planning for the areas where we're anticipating change soon and try to get ahead of that growth now. So when we have, in this example, you have a small urban village in the top left, a large urban village in the bottom right, In these cases, you'd have different study areas for the local area plan, and you'd also have a totally different type of plan for a corridor, transportation corridor. So previously, we didn't have the flexibility to take on this type of planning, corridor planning, and different types of study areas of different scales and looking at different issues. But this plan enables us to do that with our local area plans. So one of the first steps after this OCP is adopted will be starting to talk about the local area planning process, which is what we're really excited about as a planning team, as we get to go ahead and look at some more detailed issues across the city. So finally, going along with the theme of planning where planning is needed, what we've done is outline a blueprint for our local area planning. We realize that we can't do everything all at once. We don't have the resources for that. But what we can do is do this intelligently and look at the map and think about which areas are in need of planning. And this is what we've come up with in consultation with the community. And what it shows is in the red, you see the area of Douglas Street Corridor and roughly Burnside Gorge. That's been identified as the number one priority for local area planning. And there are a couple of reasons for that, but namely, you have the proposed rapid transit or sort of heavy transit investment in that corridor. We also have Mayfair Mall designated as a large town center in the OCP. So there are a few reasons to support this, including the transportation and the land use vision, why we would look at that area first. And then we have this schedule here of which areas we'd look at next, and then down to the priority four, which are the areas that we don't anticipate extreme change immediately, and for that reason, we put them off for now. So I'm gonna hand it over to Helen, who's going to talk a little bit more about some of the directions for North Park. And we have some graphics that are a little bit more explicit about the neighborhood, in case you have any questions up to this point.
Without getting into question period, it would really help me to know how many, just by raising hands, how many people are either part of the land use committee, and anyone who was here when we came with the draft plan. That way I know who's more new to all of this and how much background that I need to give once we get into North Park. So are there people here who were here when we came about this time last year? So quite a few people. And how many people are actually on the Land Use Committee and regularly see development? Just Alice, okay, that's helpful. So I'm just gonna take a step back really quickly and explain that the entire city of Victoria, about two-thirds of it today, are already in a development permit area. And development permit areas are, as Mark was saying, about urban design, and sometimes they're about environmental protection as well, but the vast majority of development permit areas we have are about having oversight as a city and as the different communities across the city in what the city looks like when new applications come in. And then also we have heritage conservation areas, which is probably more straightforward, which is about stewarding and taking care of heritage properties like the one that we're in, but it's also about finding ways to grow within that context through sensitive infill, and development permits are also about sensitive infill. We've broken up the city into what are usually called land designations, which are the different types of uses and the different heights and how dense the city can be, which is a combination of height and exactly how much development in terms of stories, but in terms of how wide it is and all of those details. And because we wanted to get feedback on that with the draft, we didn't do the development permit work until after we'd done a round of consultation last year. And then what we did was look for patterns in those different types of densities and uses, and then we could see how to organize what types of areas we have across the city in terms of common types of character. So, yes, we were trying to be consistent, but really the real point is to try to figure out what kind of places we have, what kinds of patterns they have, and how to work with that to keep growing and evolving in a way that the different neighborhoods and the broader community want to evolve with different kinds of growth. And so this map that you see in front of you, basically everywhere that's in white wasn't in a development permit area. It's not quite that straightforward, but basically. And all of that area of white is now also a development permit area. So the key thing to know is that in the proposed plan, the whole city will be in one development permit or another, but they don't overlap, or it's not confusing. They're either in one development permit area or you're in a different one. And I can talk about that in more detail in the question period if people have specific questions. So about this time last year, a colleague came on our team, came to talk to Norman Park, and there were three things that were said at the meeting that were providing feedback on what we did with that in the plan. The first is there was a little bit of need to clarify the fact that we have a brand new downtown plan, which we approved just last fall, and how does that relate to the official community plan? The downtown plan is a type of local area plan that happens to be mostly downtown, but overlaps some surrounding neighborhoods, including North Park. Because the OCP is a citywide plan, it is incorporating everything that's in the downtown plan. So there's no inconsistencies, because the OCP is the plan for the whole city, and because we've just finished the downtown plan, it was pretty easy to just incorporate it into the OCP. And that's what we'll be doing with each neighborhood plan and every type of local area plan. And let me just go back to that for a second. Alex knows this very well, but what we're proposing is that we don't, not that we do away with neighborhood plans, but that we open the door to being able to do planning at different scales. And sometimes that's across neighborhood boundaries, and sometimes maybe it's just a village. And wherever there is a need to focus on land use and related issues like beautification, public realm improvements, transportation planning, other issues, we can do it whatever scale needs to be done without necessarily doing a whole neighborhood plan if most of a neighborhood plan is working just fine. So we can do a village, we can do just four blocks, we can overlap boundaries, or we can do a whole neighborhood. One other issue that was raised was that Crystal Pool is just fine, but there's a need for more community space. And that also, there were some questions about, because the downtown plan is increasing that increased density, in particular in parts of North Park, and I have a map to show you, that there needed to be a transition to where there's lower density actually in North Park. And I'll go through exactly what we've done in the OCP and what was done in the downtown plan. So every neighborhood has something called neighborhood directions, their own 2 to 3 pages in the OCP that came out of what's in the existing neighborhood plans and the last 2 years of talking to the residents in the different neighborhoods, and then broader consultation as well. And in the case of North Park, there was also consultation done on the downtown plan. So in picking up on the points that were raised, just to walk you through your neighborhood. So the downtown plan did raise densities quite extensively, but there is substantial transitions along Pandora and facing Pandora, but actually not on this block. The range of densities go up to 5 to 1. And the same is true as you come all the way up to Caledonia. But these blocks and these blocks, even though they're considered to be in an urban place residential called core residential, are actually only 1 to 2 in terms of density. So what that means in ordinary English is the tall buildings are here and along here, but here we're being careful to transition to the lower density neighborhood areas, all the way through to the sort of beigey yellow color is primarily today zoned for single family dwellings and duplexes. And none of that is changing. So overall we're maintaining the existing zoning to be low density here, low to mid all through here and all through here, a little bit higher in the village because having more density in the village supports local businesses that have an intensive population. But of course it doesn't have to be necessarily in the village itself. We need the commercial mix. But by increasing density here and through here, that's a way of making the immediate village more viable.
Is that a quick comment about that now?
Yeah.
Was this on there?
Yeah.
Just wondering about the North Park Village for a lot of the neighborhood and a lot of the neighbors.
Yeah.
Think that when you look at the village and you're just, you know, walking through it, kind of when you think about it, it kind of really seems to go from Pandora to Caledonia. And I'm wondering
right.
if that's been taken into account.
Right. So, great question, because the next question about how to deal with not only transitions but the other local land use issues and related issues are that Mark mentioned that as we do finer grain planning now, we're going to be doing it in stages. And the first stage, it's true, is the Douglas Street corridor because we're expecting rapid transit and there will be tremendous change adjacent in Burnside. But our next set of priorities includes the village in North Park. And at that stage, so let's say this is minimum 3 years away, realistically probably 5 to 6, we would be doing a dedicated plan for the village. And at that time, all the potential of the village whether it's looking at zoning changes, whether it's looking at transportation issues. I understand from Alex that you're already in contact all the time with our transportation engineers. You don't have to wait for a local area plan to do that, but sometimes you do need to actually do it comprehensively. What I'm saying is that when we did this, we were actually quite conservative in terms of not being consistent with existing zoning. And these parcels down here, although there's definitely an argument, and there were people who expressed the opinion that this is part of the village, we don't want to make that change until we actually do that directly involves the business owners and everybody else in North Park. Currently, the zoning that is direction, there's a need to change it to purple, if they will get to change to purple. But our starting point is respecting the existing neighborhood plan for North Park and the existing zone.
I have one quick follow-up question.
Yeah.
So I guess regarding the issue of Cook Street in North Park Village.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, again, when we're walking around there, it's just like the village, it is both sides of the street, not
yeah.
just the one side of
yes,
the North
sure.
Park. I'm just wondering, if that's also taken into consideration.
And that's exactly why we don't want to only do neighborhood plans now, because when we do the village plan, most of the villages in the city overlap different neighborhoods. So we would absolutely, the study area would absolutely include the other side of the street. So let me know if this isn't completely clear, because this is getting a little bit technical, but right now, today, there's a development permit area that includes North Park. It's simply called Paris Green North Park. And where you see the hatched area, including these parcels up here, are part of that current development permit area. We've extended a permit area for this part of North Park, including where there isn't hatching, because in the downtown core area, everything within the black boundary is considered one district, and in the OCP, it's all the same land designation. So it's all the same mix of uses, range of densities, range, not ceiling. And so in order to bring together that overall vision, both in the overall city plan and in the downtown plan, it makes good sense to put it all in one permit area. So this is one development permit area. This brand new DPA, which is just dealing with form and character, is covering part of North Park. So what that means is there's a part of North Park that isn't in a development permit area today that will be in the proposed plan. The purpose of this development permit area is new development that is three units or more residential, commercial or industrial. And in North, so everything that's a color. Yellow is R3 or more, so multi-unit residential, three units or more. Pink is commercial, and you have one parcel that's industrial in the whole world. What this will mean is that today, if someone wants to develop one of those sites, they can come in and just get a building permit. We don't look at it as planners. It just goes straight to building permit. With this new approach, anything that's new development or an addition to an existing building will be looked at for urban design.
And just in the hatched area you're talking about?
No, the opposite. Here's some of the back. So this area is a different development permit area. And almost all the land parcels in that area were already in a permit area called Paris Green and North Park. Most of the parcels in the non-hatched area where you see the colors isn't in any permit area. So this is really just a boundary expansion in the hatched, where you see color is brand new. That's covering North Park. If we just wanted to close, we're at the end of our process, so this is after the fact, but we We wanted to share that we have been doing, in addition to going to every community association, public information sessions. We had an open house last night and one last week. And in addition to that, it was public, but more technical. We really do have it cut off on the left-hand side. For the design and development community, including anyone who works on applications, including the land use committees. We had one session specifically on all the new designated areas. So all the new development permit areas, all the new heritage conservation areas. And by new, I mean everything in the new plan. So areas that were already controlled, but they've got new, everything has a new boundary. So we went through. And to reiterate, and this is in your takeaway, that the public hearing is on the 27th. So this is the end of the presentation. I have brought, so we mentioned design guidelines. Because we've got a brand new development permit area, we also put together brand new design guidelines, which are for multi-unit residential, commercial and industrial, and they are, so they, these are for where you saw all the colors on the map, any new applications on those sites. And there is also a couple of other development permit areas that they're being used for, and specifically in the Rock Bay area, because we also created a new area in there. And
didn't that also apply to the hatch area though?
They have their own design guidelines. All the areas that were already being looked at by planning already have design guidelines. So these are new for new areas. So I'll pass around. And we have a stash, yes. We'll leave those as well.
So there are no new beautiful lines that are going to be back to
no more fancy.
There is still a
secret.
Yes.
My home is in the hatched area.
Okay.
So that was not previously part of the downtown development permit area, which now it is, according to what I understand, it's been appropriated into that. So that would have the.
Do you want to show me?
That would have guidelines as well.
So
you're in the purple.
So you're saying that you're somewhere here?
I'm in North Park off of Cook Street. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, I'm not. Sorry.
So you're in the UDP here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So those guidelines are for here.
So these ones would be for me.
But to be clear, this is only for new development additions. It's not for changes to existing buildings other than making
right.
Them
bigger. Exactly.
So it doesn't mean that going to need a permit to do something to your property unless you're adding to.
I understand. Can you also expand on what industrial means?
Mm-hmm. Sure. So the city is broken into zones and industrial is defined in the zoning bylaw. Our zoning bylaw has almost 400 zones and about 25 industrial ones. But broadly speaking, there is heavy industry, which is not going to be North Park, that's going to be Rock Bay and right along the harbors, like where Ship Point is. Light industrial, which most zones are light industrial. And light industrial includes everything from any kind of high-tech manufacturing all the way through to jewelry design, sculpture, those kinds of activities. They're uses that sometimes have a commercial component, so it gets a little bit complicated, but they're uses that aren't traditionally considered part of a residential area because they smell or there's something else about them that traditionally made them inhospitable, but in today's world, obviously, high tech and those kinds of activities don't fall into that category, but they're still considered industrial.
As opposed to commercial?
As opposed to commercial. Commercial means that there's trade happening on the site,
right.
Whereas industrial, not usually. And if there is, it'll be a mixed zone that's partly being able to see customers and selling things, and partly producing. That's the simplest way to put it.
Yeah,
the industry is about the production.
Can you also tell me or define for me what 1 to 2 or 5 to 1 means?
Okay, so we didn't include a diagram, but if you imagine your property, the land, 1 to 1 means that you cover the whole surface of the land once in terms of square feet. 2 to 1 means you do it twice. So when you start factoring in building away from the road, it's obviously going to get taller to be able to fit in all of that square footage. So it's a basic ratio about how much square feet on the overall parcel and how many times that square footage per permitting. And
so does 5 to 1 mean 5 stories?
Not necessarily. It means that if you could build 5,000 square feet, if your parcel is 5,000 square feet, which is not a very big lot, but just to make it really straightforward, it means what you build would be 25 square feet. But how many stories that is depends on what the setbacks are, other, and then design requirements we want. Maybe we want when you start to get to something that's more than 3 stories, we want there to be something that's really friendly to pedestrians on the bottom, and then we want to go skinnier on the top. So there are design considerations as well. But in the most straightforward way, in theory, it might mean 5 stories, but it doesn't work out that way because sites are always weird shapes, and it depends what you're able to build. But the total square footage is that simple basic ratio.
Okay, I still don't understand.
The ratio of the square footage of all the floors of the building compared to the square footage of the entire lot area.
There we go.
So if your lots if your 5 to 1 ratio, if your lots at 5,000 square foot, you have 25,000 square foot of floors. And you can
is that clear? So
times 5 is 25. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So if you think of your own property, mm-hmm. obviously it's not covering a whole piece of land. Let's say it's a third. So the amount of square footage will be making it taller depending on how much of it you fill up.
I see.
And how much you're allowed to fill up because of the zone and the design.
Can you be a little bit more specific about traffic hierarchy? You mentioned, I think, pedestrians, cyclists, and public transport. It doesn't, because being a pedestrian or cyclist is a limited description of personal ways of transporting oneself. Because there's skateboards and then there are motorized scooters.
Yeah. So
or scooters that are pushed with your foot.
Right.
So
razor scooters.
So the city actually defines skateboarders and some of those other uses as pedestrians. And all this means is that we want all of our roads to be friendly to all these uses. But if it's a local road versus a really busy road, that's going to be done in different ways.
Okay.
and in even though this doesn't actually say long orders and electric bicycles and scooters and all of that,
they're considered to be pedestrians.
Most of them are Because they, anything that uses the sidewalk is considered a pedestrian within our current system.
Well, therein lies the problem.
Possibly.
Because that's going to be conflictual,
and,
as it
and
is
that,
now.
That's definitely a challenge, for sure.
And so what are the plans for that, to resolve those difficulties?
We have our city transportation led by engineering, who use this approach. This actually really comes from them. They're really committed to it. But this is what I'm talking about, is really just very high level. They have it kind of worked out for each type of street. Again, local, arterial, secondary arterial. But that said, it is an ongoing challenge. What they've done in recent years is put together what's called the pedestrian master plan, which looks at everything from which sidewalks in James Bay need to be widened because they're just too narrow for anybody, all the way through to monitoring the different types of pedestrians, because that's what we're talking about, that are high traffic in different areas, and coming up with solutions. And they're doing it in an area by area way. Transportation actually has transportation plans for neighborhoods that, when we do the rest of the planning, we'll be doing that together as we continue to move forward. But they've been working on neighborhood transportation plans for about a decade.
And it's called Pedestrian Master Plan.
That's right.
Okay.
And it's on the city's website.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes.
Well, so along with similar lines regarding North Park Village, in the development of that, there is some concern in the neighborhood about safety in terms of the walkability and cycleability in the village itself, because it is designated as an artery.
Right.
But there's a lot of mixed use of transportation in there.
Right.
And, you know, if you look at Quadra Village, they've been able to adopt a 40 km/h speed limit there.
Yes.
And that's also an artery, so there's such a precedent that's set there that I think there's a lot of thought within the neighborhood here that, you know, it's something we want to make our neighborhoods more safer for those alternative transportation.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering what's the best way for us to address that, to incorporate that within
this has come up before, and we've communicated that feedback to our transportation colleagues. The next step would be working directly with transportation engineering, which Alex can speak to that in more detail. It's definitely something that is being talked about right now, not just speeds, but other aspects of making the immediate area around North Park Village friendly to all modes. We don't get into that much detail in the citywide plan, but those kinds of improvements definitely you can talk to transportation about that right now. You don't have to wait for a whole planning exercise, and I do understand that that's already started to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I came in late, so I don't want to cause you to repeat yourself.
No problem.
But I just have the one question, just to follow up on one of those comments. Is there a process that's being put into place to work directly with the neighborhood associations for each of their concerns or their wish list and things, as well as communication about what kind of work is already in the plans or in process? You know, we've got a lot of things going
answer is that a lot of the things that we've been told as an OCP team North Park is interested in doing, you don't need to wait for a whole plan. There are things that you can work with transportation on, not only things like speed, but public realm improvements that have been talked about. And every community association can talk directly to any city department. Anything that we've heard over the last 2 years, because we've been here a few times, we have passed on where it's not really a citywide issue. And where it's a longer term issue, we, as a community planning team, talk to the community associations. We've been talking to them regularly for the last 2.5 years, and we'll keep doing that. And when it comes time to do anything that needs an overall land use plan in the village or broader North Park, there's a file on that, and we know what those issues are. But with some of these, some of the beautification matters that have come up this year, there doesn't need to be a plan for that necessarily. But the other thing to keep in consideration, though, is of course, with capital projects, there's only a certain amount of money, and their decisions have to be made about different parts of the city. But I would encourage the community association to continue talking directly to whichever departments you need to talk to. And if you want to talk about anything more specifically, I can, if it's not just transportation, I can direct you to the right people.
That seems to be a bit of a hurdle. If I was kind of kept getting directed to the North Park planner, but then the North Park planner really is only responsible for land use.
That's right.
Specific.
That's right.
So yeah, it was just a bit of a disconnect in,
right,
in trying to find out which department for which. And
right.
So I guess we could use our liaison.
Well, you're also welcome to call us. I'll leave some business cards.
Sure.
The way that maybe this isn't common knowledge, but the planning and development department's not very big, but we are basically split in two.
Mm-hmm.
There are planners who work with the applications as they come in, and then there are planners that I'm part of the team of that work on the longer term, the big picture, right,
mm-hmm,
and the long term. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, I think one thing I was just going to mention that the area that Luke was talking about there, down from Mason down to Pandora on
mm-hmm
Cook,
right,
not being in the village, a big portion of that piece is Wellburn's, which is a historic property,
right,
a designated property, and it can't, and I say it can't be touched, but you know. So it's sort of, although it's in the core plan, it's still not, it's probably never going to get touched, so it's,
yeah,
you know, it's probably.
For us as a team, I'm not sure that Wilburn's has any actual official heritage.
Yes,
inside.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
I would have to look that up. It really does come down to, there are specific zones for North Park Village. And that area between Mason and Pandora isn't the same zoning. It really is just basic. The Wellburn site is a version of CA1, a really basic commercial zone. And the same is true with the adjacent property going up Cook Street. So we. This is a really important message to get out. This is not written in stone. I mean, we're out here as staff, having done our own work and done a lot of talking to a lot of people. But if we didn't get something right, now is the time to get to the council, because there will be changes that happen at the public hearing. That's the point of this stage. So if the community association wants to communicate that to council, that the village which the purple area should be all the way down to Pandora. Now, now is the time to do that.
Is this on the site?
The whole OCP, one other, this two-pager has our project website on as well. And the whole OCP is on the website, and it's actually broken down into user-friendly PDFs. So you can look at the whole thing if you want. If you only want to look at that part of it, just look at it.
The changes on the site are in use.
Well, we've definitely gone over our agenda. But we're here for as long as we want.
It'd be good to leave your cards, because I don't actually see your names and contact information on this one sheet.
So,
because I understood that you would continue on beyond, even beyond the public hearing, to be supportive to this group, eh?
Yeah, so there is a phone number on here, and it's right at the bottom. That is the direct line to Project Lead for the OCP, whose
right.
name is Dennis. But we, but that doesn't mean that she can't phone me. So that's his direct line. That's not a
Cameron Scott.
Cameron Scott. So we're welcome to call Cam or myself. And my phone number. It's right there.
Do I have one of your cards on?
There's it's circulating, and if I've got some additional ones as well. And please know that that's not only for this process, but as, you know, as time goes on, I talk to Alex quite frequently for those longer terms. And if you simply need to know who to talk to deal with things that planning doesn't directly do, very happy to direct you.
I'm just curious if you've read Jean Miller's article in Focus this month.
I haven't. I haven't had any time to read
it. Well, you found it quite interesting.
Is what is the topic?
Not happy with the lack of movement by the city.
In planning?
And well, in general, he refers to some plans that were a strategic plan in 1997 that's basically not changed.
Oh, okay.
In his opinion.
Oh, in Jean, yes. I haven't read it, but I had a 45-minute conversation with Jean at the open house last night.
Oh, good.
I know what he thinks.
Yes, I
and do. His input is useful. So we'll also use some of these design guidelines, because there is a big chunk of North Park that this could apply to, that this needs to apply to. And if there are no further questions, then we'll just quietly pack up. You have the rest of your meeting.
I was just thinking that. We're having a festival this weekend, so yeah, we could use some of those.
Okay, great. So how many would you like? We've got about
a staff.
Sure. Well, we'll leave all the ones that we have here, and the two pager for how to give
just put it on
comments.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you very much.